calling you every single day, all day. You didn't get the message?
Do you want to get my response?
Yes, sure.
Let's hear it.
The three council members.
Yes.
It's their district. It's not my district.
No, so but they, you're they, the, you're, as the
no,
speaker.
No, if they request a hearing, I'll do a hearing.
They did request it.
They did not request a hearing. Those three councilmen, they request a hearing, we'll do a hearing. They haven't requested
seriously?
A hearing. Yes, they have not requested
so,
a hearing.
I have a question. I just want to clarify.
I have a doc's appointment.
Okay, so.
No, but we're
actually,
so
stay away from
you.
I have to go get a COVID
so,
test.
So I just want to clarify what you said. So you're saying Justin Brandon did not request an oversight hearing?
He's not the council member.
I'm sorry,
it's
what?
The three council members who represent the area.
But he's the chair of the waterfront
That's
resiliency.
Not the way it works. Okay. If it's not to do with someone's district, they have to request it for their district. That's the way it always has worked.
Oh, you mean Carlina.
Carlina's Margaret
the rat that sold us out. We know that.
What I'm saying is they have to request
Margaret
it.
Margaret Chin and Carlina have betrayed the neighborhood, so then we're screwed because they betrayed us?
Well, if they're going to be a hearing, it's their district.
But I know, but you're saying that we can't, there's never been an environmental impact statement of any significance. Nobody's ever actually really looked at this plan, and definitely
not. Well, someone should send me that.
And not
I wasn't,
since
you know, it was, the three of them worked on it together.
The three meaning
the three
Carlina?
Members, yeah, it was a ULURP that was jointly over three districts.
Right, right, so it's Carlina,
so the speaker
it's
doesn't
Chen,
get involved.
And who's the third person?
Keith Powers.
Now, see, they're all on the wrong side, though.
Point.
They're all, like, wanting
Justin
to.
Justin Brandon and James Gennaro privately come and say,
well, they should publicly
we,
say that.
We want an oversight hearing,
they
and they are
they
saying,
should publicly
so,
say that.
And you need to publicly say that as well.
No,
because we're sitting here and your office is not responding and you're not
it's
responding.
It's not my office. I told you the three council members.
But you could have told us that. There's been two or three months that we've been trying to contact you. You knew what we wanted to talk to you about.
No, I didn't actually.
You didn't,
you've gotten so many phone calls and emails, and they've been in great detail. You've gotten letters. Maybe the people who work for you don't give you a mail, but it can't be true.
Well, now we're in touch face-to-face.
Yeah.
We're telling you
Corey, I voted for you.
I voted for you. I like your shirt.
Thank you.
Now we're face-to-face. Sorry. We're saying...
I just told you.
No, you don't want to hear what I want to say,
but I'm telling you.
You can't, as the speaker of the city council, you can't call
it
oversight.
That's not the way it works.
I mean, but you do not want to hurt people in the East Village in the Lower East Side, but you know that's what's going to happen when 1,000 trees get taken down. And these guys are the engineers.
You're not listening to me.
But, yeah, go ahead.
We're hearing you.
You're telling me you have no power? But that's what every politician we talk to.
Do you want me to respond or not?
Go ahead. Let's hear it.
Okay. As I said, the three members whose districts it relates to, they need to be involved. The speaker doesn't get involved in other people's districts, ever. Let me finish.
Okay.
Let me finish. Then we can have a conversation.
Great.
We can have a conversation. So that's number one. Number two is that ULURP that was done in whatever year that was, 2018?
2019.
I wasn't involved. The three members were involved.
Right.
So all the details that you're telling me,
uh-huh.
There are hundreds of ULURPs that happen every single year.
Mm-hmm.
The speaker's not involved in all those ULURPs. The members work with the staff
mm-hmm.
in the council
mm-hmm.
that are separate from me, and they work with the applicant, which in this instance was the city, to negotiate things.
Mm-hmm.
So anything that you're telling me right now related to all the details around it,
mm-hmm.
I wasn't involved in that
mm-hmm.
because those three members were. They jointly sat down together with the Department of City Planning and they were involved.
But let me ask you a question. So if those three sold out their neighborhood and their district, we who live there are just screwed? We have no recourse because you don't have power?
You have to lobby them. A member wouldn't come into my district.
NYCHA is cited.
That's not the way it works.
NYCHA is endlessly cited.
The neighborhoods elect their representative.
I know, but listen, but the neighborhood.
And that representative has a stake over the community.
We could clarify. We could get just another minute or two. Let's clarify. Say your question.
Well, I just want to say that NYCHA is continually cited by de Blasio and Carlina as needing protection. They're scared. They're vulnerable. But in fact, NYCHA sent thousands of petitions to Carlina's office, and she refused to see those people. And she said they don't know what they signed.
There are 50 other members. I'm not involved in what happens with all their constituents.
But wait a second, this is Manhattan. Can I just say this? This is Manhattan.
Yes.
This Central Park and this East River Park,
yes.
There is no park anywhere near the size of that in Manhattan. Do you realize the impact on our
forgive
lives
me for
that's
not
going to make?
The, forgive me for not
you
knowing
know
the
that it's a big deal. You know 60 acres in Manhattan on the riverfront. If we look at Hudson River and we look at the
sound
east.
Like you want to have, I'm trying, I'm standing here,
but
I'm not
want,
leaving, I'm trying
not,
to have a con. I'm listening,
not listening
to you.
Okay, good.
Yes,
then
I am.
Why are you not? Yeah, so I'm talking.
I'm telling you how it works with the local members. local members don't get involved in my district. I don't get involved in local members.
Well, I know, we know it's called dependency.
What about the state senators and assembly members who represent the Israel Park? I'm seriously asking, I don't know. So, what are they saying?
So my question is, at this point in time,
yes,
with this current scenario, which is that the notice to proceed for IPC to begin the destruction of a 50-acre park.
I'm not trying to, I just want you to know. I don't know any of this.
No, I know
so
you don't. So I'm telling you, now you know.
You do know what Esker is.
Now you know.
No, I don't know what
the
Esker is.
East Side Coastal Resilience.
Okay, now I know what it is. I haven't been involved in it. So
okay,
now you're
well,
telling
now
me.
You know.
Yes.
We're doing the face-to-face, which is great. And we'll keep it as brief as possible.
I'm just going to, because I've
sure,
got a COVID
sure,
test,
yes,
so
yes.
I don't want to expose it. I have to get
I could put this on as well.
Whatever you feel safe.
The question now is, we're at this point that the company is, within the next bit of time, few weeks, could come in and start the destruction of a 50-acre park that is vital to the lives of thousands of New Yorkers. And we're terrified. We have reached out to every level of elected official possible.
What
and we have done this.
And
so, hold on. We have reached out to everyone. And at this point in time, what every level of every political official, state, city, federal, what everyone has told us directly in writing, has said, we must have a city council oversight hearing. Justin Brannon and James Gennaro of their respective committees have told us that they support having an oversight hearing on the East Side Coastal Resiliency Plan, which is the plan that is about to start to obliterate a 50-acre park rammed through by de Blasio to bulldoze 1,000 mature trees. We are terrified. Every elected official, their response, we have written beautiful letters, edited, took many emails to get the language right, let me tell you. And we have done that work, and every single one says, get Corey to allow an oversight hearing on the East Side Coastal Resiliency Plan. That is what we need next.
It's my understanding no members have requested a hearing.
So okay, let's go from there. So what we need from you as community members is we need you to publicly then say that what we're saying, what they are telling us, is inaccurate information. You need to publicly get up and say that Justin Brannon and James Gennaro have not requested an oversight hearing, because otherwise we have hundreds of people writing emails and calling your office, and many people are very angry because your office has not responded. And I understand what you're saying is that they haven't requested it.
I don't get involved in other districts.
Well, you're the Speaker
don't.
Of City Council,
the,
so you have oversight
of
scheduling hearings.
And no hearing has been requested of me, to my knowledge.
I understand.
I will check with staff.
I understand.
But to my knowledge, no hearing has
okay,
been requested.
Okay, so what we need from you, that's what I'm at. I hear
I'm
you
telling
what
you
saying.
Right now, people are recording this.
Well, no.
So, I mean, everyone's going to...
No.
In 20 minutes, it's all going to be on the internet, so
well,
it's fine.
What I'm asking from you is to put in writing that this has occurred, that you have not received a request.
People are reporting
from
me right now,
okay,
and I am saying very publicly,
I could still ask.
It is my understanding that no hearing has been requested of me.
Okay, well, we want to make things official. You know how it goes.
There are five cameras reporting me. I'm
okay.
Say for the third time.
Okay.
It is my understanding that no hearing has been requested of me.
So you are saying that both of those, that Justin Brannon and James Gennaro, have not requested
that's my understanding.
A hearing. So there's
with,
no...
I will check with staff.
Okay.
My understanding is there have been no hearings requested.
Okay, and so once they do make an official request... Once you do make an official request, we are asking you that we must have an oversight hearing, because we are scared for our community and for our lives. Because without 1,000 mature trees, that's the, I don't know if I, you're saying you're
FDR
not familiar.
FDR is going to poison the
but
neighborhood.
The de Blasio.
FDR is going to poison the neighborhood. The only thing between our health and is those and toxicity is are those trees.
Oh God, I now understand what you're saying.
Scott Stringer did not sign the contract to allow the East Side Coastal Resiliency Project in Project Area 1. He did not sign that contract because there were problems. And
I don't know this.
Well, now you know.
Why do you keep saying that? I don't know that.
Now you know. Now you know.
It's a big city issue.
This is great. Now you know.
That there was a plan.
That we have
to tell the community.
So now you know. But
Hudson River Park is a big park.
So
from Chambers to 59th
Street. That's like a rich man's playground. You know that.
So now you know that Stringer did not sign off on this because there were many problems.
When did this happen?
It happened.
It didn't happen.
June 27th.
Okay. So he did not sign, and what happened was several days later.
We were all down here protesting at the municipal building.
Several days, and Stringer labels himself as an environmentalist, right? He sent it back to the DDC, and several days later, de Blasio did an override and registered the contract with a company that Stringer. We have the report. We have Stringer's report. Why this company is not qualified?
Why is that?
There's many reasons. I could send you the foiled report, but in that report, it does say that Stringer did not receive the documents required to show, to demonstrate that this company has the qualifications. It's a newly formed conglomerate. And so to trust a company that Stringer says didn't provide the required documents to trust them to endeavor on a $2 billion project that decimates the most important open public space in Lower Manhattan is terrifying to our community members. And once those trees are cut, they will. It's over. This is a tragedy that we could prevent.
When's it supposed to start? When are they supposed to start?
They got the notice to proceed. So there's a little bit of paperwork between.
It could start in the next 6 weeks. We expect. I spoke with the community liaison that represents from the DDC, that represents the Eastside Coastal Resiliency Project. I spoke with her yesterday, and she anticipates within the next 2 months, they could begin to literally bulldoze with 1,000 mature trees and obliterate a 50-acre park that is full of rare and threatened insects and birds. Not to mention thousands of children will have no place to go.
That's a problem.
We're actually terrified. And what we see the city doing is obliterating public space that is not being able to be monetized. East River Park takes a lot of money to maintain. And so we're terrified that the city is taking advantage of that, and that we will lose. If they begin this project, we will lose this park. And so we've been here since Monday, and we've been actually calling you a lot and looking for you all over the place.
Which is awesome that you walked through.
Can I add something? Harvey Epstein, who's the assembly member,
yes, I know Harvey.
Calls it alienation of parkland. And he said
that requires a state legislature.
And he said,
we sued the city for that, and we lost last summer. And so it's under appeal right now. We have two lawsuits.
And did a judge make any findings in the case?
No, November, I think, is the case.
Hi, how are you?
Hello. Fine, thank you. Good.
I only have a couple minutes. I have a doctor's appointment. Seriously.
We really appreciate you spending the time with us.
I advocate for the park because I actually truly live in the area. And I used that park. I was 210 pounds, and I would go to that park and run the tracks, run the stairs, sit next to the water, just simply relax and enjoy the quiet and the pieces of the park. And if you're gonna take away, for me, it's so much more about your mental health and just having a place to go and relax and sit. And I do understand that Hurricane Sandy, but I also see that on the FDR, you have a lot of ways that which you could put walls there to prevent the water from going over to the other place instead of destroying the park. You have to find some other way. I grew up in the islands. My island is a literally flat water, and if we get a hurricane, we are at danger so many times of literally losing all of us. My mom, we are scared, but we don't destroy the ocean. We do not allow. We do not stop it. We just find other ways for us to live in the buildings and stuff like that, and just let the flow of the water go. So you do have a way to just put the walls up for the FDR so the water could stay in the park, like someone said in at the time.
You weren't standing here when I said it before, and I'm being totally honest. I'm not familiar with all of the details. You know, the way it works with land use applications is the local council member, usually it's one council member, in this instance it's three council members, they're the ones who get delegated to deal
with
it.
Well, we're asking for your help.
I understand. I'm just explaining.
Would you be willing to have a meeting with us so we could tell you more?
I'd be happy to have you send me information. I'm glad we're having this conversation.
Me too.
I
was in P-Town this summer, and I heard you were there, and I was like, where is he? I was looking around.
Yeah,
there you are.
Yeah.
Deference.
They said you were staying at the old Vic.
Deference is not a hard
one. That wasn't true.
Deference is not a hard one.
Yeah.
I have a house in the West End. Not mine. It was a rental.
I'm in your district. Deference is not a hard rule, and they had a really good. There's a really good plan that was in place before this current plan came up that the public approved of, and agencies approved of, and everything else.
HUD funded it. Forgive me for not knowing this, and I don't mean this.
Well, let's have a sit down, and we could fill you in because we're scared what's going
to
happen.
Standing here, I haven't left. I'm trying to have a conversation right now, so I want to ask you a question.
Sure.
Forgive me for not knowing this. I'm not saying this like in a rhetorical way. When the ULURP went through in 2019, were all of these objections and this organizing taking place at that time?
Oh, absolutely.
And presented to those three council members?
Yes, I'm sure. Absolutely.
Because from my feeling and sense, maybe I'm wrong, I haven't been close to the project, it feels a lot more organized now than it felt then.
No.
Because I don't remember in 2019 it being like this.
I know in the city council meeting, I know that there was like hours of testimony, and I heard 90% of it was against it, and there were environmental experts saying this is wrong, and all the community members were like, no, and then the city council just went and voted for it.
So the three council members, I know you guys are not fans of theirs, given what you said. But have you all requested a meeting? Have you requested that they have a hearing on this, what you're asking me?
That's what we've been doing.
From them?
That's why we're frustrated.
And what are their offices saying in response?
Carlina won't respond to us on any level.
No response?
None. We've been outside her office.
Margaret and Keith?
Same
no
deal.
One has responded. The only thing that any elected official has responded is to speak to you about allowing an oversight here.
They all say it's a done deal.
Esker is short for East Side Coastal Resiliency Plan. Okay. So can we be in touch?
Carlina was on one side before the city council voted, and you know, up until very close to it, her and Gail Brewer even commissioned a study by a company called Deltares to look at all the plans and stuff.
But you're saying there were multiple plans?
There were multiple options.
Yeah,
yes. Yeah,
and included. there was a community-backed plan early on in 2018 that involved building a berm and had some construction, but left most of the park available for park use.
How come that plan wasn't?
The reason it got changed was because one day de Blasio woke up and said he was changing the plan based on a value engineering report, and he was changing it from the community-backed plan to this other plan that ripped out and bulldozed 1,000 mature trees, and it decimated the entire park and would bury it in 10 feet of fill. And we asked him why he was changing it, and he said he was changing it due to a value engineering report. So the community said, we would like to see that report. And the city did not release the report, so the community group filed a FOIL request, and the city's official response was, the report doesn't exist. A year and a half legal battle.
This was before the ULURP or after the ULURP?
It was after. It was after when de Blasio changed it to this other plan. So then we asked for the value engineering report. The city's official line was that it didn't exist. And we had to community members had to file a lawsuit and demanded to see the report. And it took a year and a half.
And they said it doesn't exist.
At first they said it didn't exist. Yes. Okay. And a year and a half later.
Carlina. She said it was a workshop. It wasn't a report.
A year and a half later, this past winter, all of a sudden, one day, the city woke up and presented us with its almost 400-page value engineering report. And they said, just kidding, it does exist. And they gave it to us, but it was almost completely redacted, like one of those torture memos from Guantanamo. So that made us even more alarmed that the city is planning on removing all the trees and making the park unusable for who knows how long. So we were terrified.
So we did another lawsuit.
I have another question for you. Forgive me for not knowing this. Yeah. So the trees that are proposed to be removed.
Every 991 trees.
So what happens in their place?
Well, what they're basically going to do, cut out all the trees, get rid of every bit of biodiversity in the park, cover it with 1 million tons of landfill, cover that with concrete, astroturf, and then put little saplings on top. So in about 30 years, we'll have shade again.
Well, no, it'll be 80 years because the trees in East River Park are actually 80 years old. So,
but I mean any shade.
Any shade at all, but we will. None of us will be alive.
There's no way to save any of these trees because they're too big. You can't take them out and replant them.
No.
You can't save
them. It doesn't matter if we could replant them somewhere else, because if you remove that bulk of tree, we will all be in much, much greater danger from flooding, because the only thing that protects us from flooding right now...
It's like a bioswale.
It's a swale. Yeah, like a swale, yeah. Good job. Yes. but it's a sponge. So yeah. We're like, we're terrified. Without the trees as sponges, we for sure will be in more danger. Without those 1,000 trees to produce shade, and trees reduce the heat.
And this is from what street to what street?
It is
Montgomery up to 23rd. And the thing is, 2 days after Sandy, the park was open. The park is really a sponge. It's completely resilient. That's what's crazy. And this thing that they're doing, which is concrete, I mean, it's not state of the art. I mean, Jamie Torres Springer was, when he came in, is when the plan came in. So it looks very much that it came from HRNA and his whole outfit. Because he's been the main promulgator.
He's at DDC, right?
He's the head
Jamie
of
Torres Springer, yeah. Yes. Yes. And so what we're terrified.
I knew the former head of DDC, Lorraine.
Right. He's the new one, and he's really pushing this as well. And he's boasting about it in his opinion piece that came out early in September.
In the Daily
where did it come out?
In the Daily News.
In his opinion piece in the Daily
about
News.
About this project?
He it's one of the things he boasts about, and you know what the other thing he boasts about? Building more jails. And so this is the sort of mentality that the DDC has, that we're actually, part of why we've been here since Monday, and part of why we're here is to make that connection and to speak about that the city's position, when you remove public space, where does the city expect us to go? What is the DDC investing in? What is the DDC working on and planning? And it's straight from his mouth in that piece, you see what he's thinking. He's removing
September
our public 10th. Space. He's removing our public space, and the answer is to build more jails, to put us in more confinement.
And soon after his piece, the Daily News ran another piece, and the headline was Green City Red Tape, and that it was time, because of the environment, to get rid of all these environmental impact studies and get rid of all the red tape so that the city can build faster. And it's just like an anti-green statement posing as greenwashing. You know?
We passed a bill today. You know, the bill, we passed
the
bill.
The big one.
The big one, requiring resiliency and flooding mitigation plans for all 500 miles of coastline in New York City.
I heard about it, but the problem we're all concerned was like, does that mean after you rape me? Because, you know what I mean? Like, what about our park? So is that like next year after our park's been destroyed? That's what's scary, you know?
I mean, just it's a great question. And the bill goes into effect in September of 2022. So yes.
See, we're screwed. So we're like the bad date that happened before you stopped drinking, you know? It's like...
So, you know, I hear you that you don't know the details of the plan. I totally hear you, but...
We left a message at Norma, with Norma Rodriguez today.
I don't know who that is.
She said she was your...
One of the people that answers your phones. Okay. Yeah. You have many nice people that answer your phones, I have to say, in particular, of any elected official. Yeah. So, I give them a lot of credit, but now you have some of the information, and we're happy to give you more.
So here, I have to leave, but here's what I would say. Glad we ran into each other.
We're totally glad.
Glad we have this conversation. I think it's important to, first of all, have an official request to me, which, again, I'll check with staff, but I don't believe I've gotten an official request to have a hearing. I'll check, but I'm almost certain that that hasn't happened. And then there's going to have to be a conversation in the body. Just so you know, I don't unilaterally make decisions. So things are done by consensus. So I don't say if half the people want the hearing and half the people don't, we try to figure out consensus.
Mm-hmm.
So that means that if a hearing is requested, we will then have a conversation internally about what that would look like and about what that would be. But I am open to it, but I haven't gotten an official request.
I see. And how can we work with you on the timeline? Because
what do you mean the timeline?
Well, the timeline is that they potentially could come in and begin
next week,
chopping down, bulldozing 1,000 trees within the next 6 weeks. And so we're pleading, and we've been doing this with all elected officials, and they all have directed us to you.
But whoever's telling you that, I don't know who they are, and I don't want to be disrespectful to them.
I
think people are trying to pass the buck a little bit.
I think
and they're trying to pass the buck, and they're trying to confuse people about my actual involvement. Yeah. Every speaker of the city council, from Peter Ballone to Gifford Miller to Chris Kringle to Melissa Rivera, the four previous speakers, they don't get involved in other people's districts. Saying Corey's going to be the one to get involved, they are misleading you about how the council actually works.
Okay, and at the same time,
and how it's worked for 35 years.
And at the same time, now that we have this conversation, we're asking for your assistance. in your position, and to then guide an emergency response. We're asking the city council for an emergency response in an emergency situation for our community, because our community is in real danger if this happens.
I'm very glad we've had this conversation. Yeah. This has been a thoughtful, respectful conversation that has taught me a lot, so I appreciate that. And I will now go talk to some folks and try to get some information.
Can we make a date to talk again to follow up soon?
Yeah, why don't you call from my office and give you a name or something to call.
Pen? Who's got a pen? I see a pen right there.
You should call. Yes. I don't want to give this person's name on camera.
Okay, well, you write it down.
I don't want this person give to get up, bombarded because they're a staff member.
Yeah, write it down private. It's fine.
Come over here.
I understand. Okay. I guess that's the end of the
talk. That was pretty.